things about the vehicles. We're going to speak just a little bit about Range Rover Sport. I mean, this is the 06 Range Rover Sport, brand new vehicle for Land Rover. Really kind of fits that niche between LR3 and Range Rover. Completely different vehicle from either of those. All right. This particular vehicle happens to be supercharged. All right. The black Land Rover oval helps to designate that supercharged badging for us. 390 horsepower with the supercharged version. The naturally aspirated Sport comes in actually at 300 horsepower. with the supercharged, we're also looking at about 410 pounds of torque with that supercharged engine. It is a 4.2 liter V8 Jaguar derived engine for us. So that's what we're looking at, 108 inch wheelbase with the vehicle. It does have another system known as dynamic response. Dynamic response is basically a system that is integrated into the sway bars and helps to keep the vehicle flat or flatter while cornering, giving it the best possible performance on road. It's still a Land Rover, so it still has all of its off-road capabilities as well. One of the things that helps us with that is a system known as CrossLink. Okay, it does have an air suspension, so we can pick and choose the ride height of the vehicle, and that CrossLink system is actually activated whenever we select the off-road height with the vehicle. Valves are opened on the springs as one spring compresses, forcing air out of that spring through a line into the spring on the opposite side, expanding it so the vehicle mimics a solid axle whenever we're off-road. And the reason why that's important for us is because it gives us a very consistent ground clearance while we're off-road, right? Very important for us, and things that will become very evident as we progress throughout the day. Also with Range Rover Sport, actually air intake, okay, here on the side, giving this vehicle 28 inches as far as wading depth is concerned. So you're looking at more than 2 feet, and as you'll notice, you know, we're looking at roughly about halfway up the height of the door. So that's a pretty substantial wading depth, okay? Brand new tailgate for us as well if we move to the rear of the vehicle. With the design of the vehicle, we've got a split gate, so we can actually just raise the top if we would like, okay, just to gain access to the cargo area, or if we needed to, being able to raise the entire gate if need be, okay? We're gonna get a lot more in depth into the vehicles as far as how the systems work, how they perform as we're driving along. So that way we don't have to stand here in the parking lot all morning, okay? Moving back to Range Rover, this is the 06 Range Rover. You'll notice that with one of the most noticeable things with the power vents is we've actually gone to 3 slats in the power vent versus 2 slats. Also a completely redesigned A-pillar, which is just helping to reduce the amount of wind noise with the vehicle. Also we have a double laminate glass with the vehicle as well. So again, being able to really isolate and reduce the amount of noise inside of the passenger compartment. With this vehicle, we have a 4.4 liter Jaguar derived V8, okay, giving us 305 horsepower with this particular vehicle. And we're looking at just about 320, 325 pounds of torque with the naturally aspirated Range Rover. With this, another design feature with this V8 engine, we've actually been able to keep the half shafts from running through the oil sump. So again, just helping to reduce the amount of vibration that is transmitted back into the passenger compartment with the vehicle. So very quiet vehicle. If you've driven the 05 Range Rovers, and if you haven't driven the 06 yet, I think you're gonna find a very, very substantial difference between the two vehicles as we're going along. So, independent suspension. Air suspension has been changed a bit for 06, basically meaning we have 3 driver selectable settings with the air suspension versus the 4 that we had in 05. And again, things that we'll talk about a little bit more in depth as we go along. Any questions so far, gentlemen? Pricing and everything is in the packets that you have, but this particular Range Rover priced as equipped is 82.5, and the Sport here we're looking at just about 72 as that one is equipped as well. Okay, but detailed pricing is in the kit that you have. Off-road. We're going to be using these vehicles off-road as well today, once we're done with our road portion this morning. Now, just a bit, maybe a bit of review for some, but three basic angles that we want to take into consideration whenever we head off-road. The first angle that we want to take into consideration is our approach angle, right? So if we were to draw a line from wherever the front tire touches the ground, so from this contact patch here out to the lowest, most forward point of the vehicle, which on these really happens to be our recovery point out here on the front most times. What we're looking for here as we come up to rock ledge, hillside, dipping down into a hole, whatever the case is, we want to make sure that the front wheels maintain contact with the planet and the front bumper does not. Because you can just imagine if you just force the bumper into the ground and then try to power through it, something's going to give, and it's usually not the hillside. Okay? So if we're not sure of the clearances, best thing to do, honestly, stop short of the obstacle, step out of the vehicle, take a look at it, and figure out what you want to do from there. Okay? We do have the advantage of being familiar with the trail that we're going to be on today, but at any point, if there's any questions or if anything's changed, you know, we'll be out of the vehicle as much as we're in the vehicle. It's just the safest way to get the job done. The second angle that we want to look for is known as our ramp breakover angle. Basically, if we were to draw a line from the lowest point in the center of the vehicle, okay, drawing a line from there down to the contact patch of the rear tire, down to the contact patch of the front tire, so thinking really like a large triangle underneath the vehicle, this tells us our ability to crest an obstacle out on the trail. So as we're going along, what we don't want to do is we don't want to just suddenly drop the vehicle on the frame, okay, call getting high centered. Now we look like a big seesaw sitting there at that point. You know, our motto is as slow as possible, as fast as necessary, so we should hear the vehicle starting to drag and scrape long before we're stuck. So if we hear that, the light bulb should be going off in our head saying, hey, this isn't working out well, so as long as it's safe to do so, let's just simply step out, take a look at it, figure out what we need to do next, instead of just forcing the issue and possibly doing any damage to the undercarriage as we're going along. The third angle that we want to look at is our departure angle. Really drawing a line from the contact patch of the rear tire out to the lowest point in the back end of the vehicle. It could be our recovery point, it could be the trailer hitch, it could be the spare tire, it could be the end caps of the bumper. Really, it depends upon what we're trying to negotiate and how we are trying to negotiate, okay? This can be the hardest angle for a lot of people to deal with simply because it sits behind the driver. And the tendency for a lot of people is once they themselves get around that tree or over that rock, they completely forget about the 6 or 7 feet of vehicle, in the case of the Range Rover, about that 40 grand worth of vehicle left behind them that needs to do the same thing. It needs to get around that same tree. Right? So as we're going along today, you know, we'll be talking simply about pivot points, very simple technique on how to adjust the side mirrors down and in so we can actually see the side and rear of the vehicle a bit clearer while we're off-road, just to keep an eye on these things as we're traveling along, so that way lessening the chance of anything going wrong for us while we're out. Okay? Kat, anything to add? Gentlemen, any questions?
The tires.
Correct?
The Sport has, looks like it has less rubber.
Correct.
Is that going to make any difference in how we approach things?
Not necessarily. The one thing that we have found with these vehicles is that the tires are a bit more road biased than we've seen in years past, but it's still actually rather amazing at what they're going to do for us today. Tire pressures make a little bit more of a difference for us. I mean, traditionally we've run the tires at a slightly lower than street pressure, but we find with these that we're keeping them at street pressure just to help maintain the integrity of the tire. So there is just a little less side, a little work.
Are those rims going to take more of a beating? Is it going to be a harsher ride?
No, not so much a harsher ride, but here's, you know, again, just another kind of an interesting thing. You'll notice that, and again, if you look at particularly 04 and 05 Range Rover, you notice that some of the rims on those vehicles actually kind of protrude out a little bit further than the actual sidewall, okay? But on the 06s, they don't. Because last year, some of the engineers were actually over here in the States out in Utah and had noticed that, hey, you know, if we continue with the rims outside of the tire, we are going to continue to crash. We are going to continue to bash them up. So they've actually designed the rims to be a little bit shallower, so to speak, so they don't actually protrude past the tire. Again, just helping to maintain, you know, that look, yeah, and that performance. But yes, tires do make a difference, honestly. You know,
what you're going to see today, some of the terrain that we're going to get into, different sets of tires would allow the vehicle to perform differently.
Yeah.
We keep everything stock, just like you would get it from the showroom. That's really the purpose of the school, is to show, here's your normal off the showroom floor type of vehicle. Here's what it can do for you.
Yeah. Cool.
Brent, anything else?
No. Good looking. Good on that with it.
They're sharp. All right. Well, gentlemen, if there's nothing else, when you're ready, we can go.
Talk about traction for a moment, right? If you were to break traction down into units of measurement, okay? So let's say you have 10 units of traction available to you. Now, if you're braking, okay, and holding the wheel straight, you have all 10 units of traction available to the braking effort, okay?
Okay.
If you're off the brakes and steering, let's say here, because we're going to be turning to the left, we now have all 10 units of traction available to the steering effort. So if we're in the corner and braking and steering at the same time, now we're kind of degrading that effort, because now we're dedicating units of traction to the steering effort and units of traction to the braking effort. So if you're doing both, maybe you have 6 units of traction available for braking, 4 for steering. So maybe that's when you break traction and slide to the corner, that type of thing. So it is better, you are better off to brake before you come down the hill, or brake before you get into the corner.
Gotcha.
Okay, and drive along for us here, Ash. If you would, both hands on the wheel, 10 and 2, 9 and 3, whatever you're comfortable with. Okay. Easy on that throttle. Big things that we're looking for, thumbs on the outside of the spokes. All right, it's outside rare, correct? It's rare, honestly, in a power steering equipped vehicle, but what could happen, if you get your thumbs wrapped around the wheel, wheel gets away from you. Trust me on this one.
Ooh.
As those spokes come around, it hurts. Okay?
Gotcha. Yeah.
So now, feel how, this isn't a bad pace, honestly.
Okay.
It's pretty good. But now let's downshift. Let's go to first gear. See how slow that is?
All right.
First gear, particularly in low range, this is where we get our max engine compression, engine braking, however you like to say it. You can really slows us down now to where we can get more control out of the vehicle.
Okay.
So we're going to use first gear like this for any downhill work,
okay?
Or if we get into a situation where we just really need to slow the vehicle down, ditch crossings possibly, log crossings, rock crossings, that type of thing, where we just want better control over the vehicle. But now let's go back to drive. Here you go. So you can, now you can kind of get a feel for it.
Okay.
All right?
So if you're in drive, is it typical to just shift quickly back into first?
Well, here's the thing. Now, good. Put us back over into manual mode. You notice that sport mode does not exist in low range.
Okay.
It goes directly to manual mode. You notice that it's gone to second gear.
Yeah, it did.
So whenever we go from automatic to manual mode, the transmission is not going to always default to first gear.
Okay. Right.
It's going to go into whatever gear the transmission is currently in.
Right. I wasn't sure if it did. I thought maybe it had at one point, or maybe it was already just going really slow when it went into first.
Correct. Okay. That you might have been going slow enough to where it was already there.
Right.
Because automatic transmissions these days,
and then would go back to drive, are basically smart enough to the point where they're not going to let themselves get into trouble. And what I mean by that is that if the vehicle speed is too great for the gear speed that you're trying to select, it's not going to downshift.
Okay.
Because the transmission looks at that and says, no, man, that's going to hurt.
Yeah.
I'm not doing it. All right?
Cool.
All right. So now here again, at the top of this hillside, just off that throttle, let's go back to first gear. All right? There's third and second. One more time. There's first. There you see how it kind of took, there's that little bit of a lapse there?
Mm-hmm.
Now we're going to talk about hill descent control.
Okay.
Okay? Now, depending upon what setting we have the terrain response in, it will activate hill descent control for us automatically. Or if, you know, need be, we just activate it by pressing the button. Second green light comes up there.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Hill descent control and traction control both tied into the ABS, tied into that braking system. They make a rather unique sound whenever they activate. Okay. And if you haven't heard them before, you will today.
Okay.
And basically, the sound is lightly exaggerated just to service and feedback to the driver that particular system is working for us.
Okay.
So if you will, just give us a little throttle through here. A little bit more, Ash, a little bit more. Now come off the throttle. Hear that sound? That's the hill descent control working for us, okay?
That sounds cool.
All right. So now as we level out down here, we'll go back to drive and we'll just keep ourselves moving along.
So that leaves hill descent on?
Hill descent control is on, all right? And there's no problem in leaving it on. We're not going to hurt anything, and we'll get a little bit more in-depth of that as we go. Slow it down. No need to fly through the holes, right? Don't know what's in the bottom of it.
Okay.
Don't know how deep it is. And if we didn't truly know, we would have gotten out and looked at it.
Okay.
But even then, you don't want to go too fast, because if you do, you get that big Hollywood splash. Mm. Makes for great photos. But
that is what I'm thinking.
Yeah. But it's now forcing water into places of the vehicle that water has no business being.
Okay.
And that's what we're trying to avoid.
Gotcha. A good point. Good pointer.
Yeah. Be that setting. Well, one more.
Oh.
There you go. Nope. Sleep there. Okay. Now you're going to notice a completely different feel in the throttle. Right? It's a little bit softer.
Yeah.
Biggest reason for this is because now we're telling the vehicle, right? Hey, we're in mud. It's going to be, it's probably going to be slippery. All right? You know, it can be traction, could be a little poor. And by having a softer throttle like that, it makes it harder for us to apply too much torque through the wheels too quickly, to over torque the wheels and just cause them to spin. Mm-hmm. So that's why you get a slightly softer, you know, feel with the throttle through here.
So I'm curious, back in the day, without all these gizmos and knobs and settings, how would a car be able to negotiate things?
It's
like this,
the driver obviously at that point has to be a lot more in tune with what's going on. You had one throttle feel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we were speaking earlier. As soon as we get to the crest here, if you would stop for me, I'll just wait for these guys to catch up a little bit. We were speaking earlier about, vehicles being underpowered.
Mm-hmm.
Earlier Land Rovers, that was always a big thing here in the US market, all the vehicles underpowered, it doesn't have this, doesn't have that. Well, it wasn't underpowered. It was just it had a very soft throttle, and it was that way on purpose, so you couldn't give it too much torque, right?
Okay.
But obviously that didn't do very well. It did great for the vehicle off-road, but for on-road, it was a bit of a drawback, you know? So now, through electronics, you can now actually tune the vehicle one way for on-road driving and tune it another way for off-road driving, just like you felt.
Right.
You get a more responsive throttle for on-road driving,
right.
And then you can tweak it a little bit there behind us. We're good.
Okay.
And then you can tweak it a bit for off-road driving, so.
So what speed should I be thinking of in my head for these?
There's no magic number. You know, I can't come off the throttle here a little bit. I can't tell you that 5 miles an hour is going to do it for you every time.
Okay.
Here's the parameters that you want to look at, okay? Quick enough to where obviously we're moving along, okay? And you know, we're at a nice pace. We're comfortable.
Okay.
Slow enough to where if we had to react to anything, okay, tree down, out on public lands, another user out here, that type of thing,
okay,
to where we could either stop the vehicle or maneuver the vehicle safely and not run the risk of sliding off of the trail or into a tree, that type of thing. So we refer to it as terrain dependent speed. So there is a little bit of a thought process there, but also realize this: the faster we go, the more bounce we create.
Okay.
The more bounce we create, the less ground clearance we're going to have, because each time we bounce, we compress that suspension,
right.
So now we're losing a little bit of ground clearance. off the throttle, back to first gear for the downhill. Here you go. Also, the faster we go like that, as we create bounce, you know, wheels are now coming up off the ground a little bit. And if the wheel's not in contact with the planet, we're losing traction, losing momentum. There you go. Easy on that throttle.
Should I follow those tracks?
You can. Or? You can stay to the left. That'd be fine. Now here, we've come into this, you know, as slow as possible. So now, do me a favor. Come off that throttle for just a moment. Let's go back to drive. Turn to your left just a touch. And now just lightly, lightly accelerate all the way across. Because as we get into the mud, we want torque being delivered to those wheels. We want them spinning. We want them rotating all the way through there. But again, not so fast that we just kind of bounce, that we just kind of bounce our way through there. Okay.
That would be a great shot to get back there.
Oh, there's
more
of
those?
A deeper one.
Ooh.
Much deeper as we go along.
Much deeper. I like the sound of that.
Much deeper. So now again here, you're always looking ahead. Again, trying to be proactive. So I mean, we're looking pretty good at this point.
Should I shift?
Yeah, we're okay. We're good. All right. Again, out of that throttle a little bit. Come in here nice and slowly. Easy. Good deal.
So bad.
Excellent. Now again, there, a little local knowledge. Alright, this is, you're going to feel the vehicle kind of settle into here. Mm-hmm. So this is a good pace. It's not too fast, but yet we're still giving the vehicle a chance to succeed, right? Still giving it enough to get through here.
Yeah.
There you go. Excellent. Now, have you ever driven with using 2 feet, Ash?
Heel toe?
Well, not so much heel toe, but more left foot to cover the brake, right foot to cover the throttle.
Not so much.
Okay. Well, it's a technique that we teach. It does lots of different things, better response times, better control over the vehicle.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things in a situation like that is we get into the mud. If we needed to keep the vehicle moving through that mud, if we needed to keep that momentum going, yet we knew that any amount of momentum would cause us to bounce a bit much and our clearances are tight, that's where we could work that brake with the left foot and a steady throttle with the right foot so we can keep the vehicle moving forward and yet control how quickly we just kind of settle down into the hole.
Yeah. Is that how? Is that a preferred method for all?
It is a preferred method. We'll work with it as we go along through here, particularly as we get into some of the deeper holes through here. What we've got here, this is our 4x4 info screen, and it actually gives us quite a bit of feedback. Upper right hand corner lets us know the suspension setting. So right now we're in the off road height. The screen beneath it also shows us the position of the wheels, meaning articulation. How are they traveling up and down? Okay. Also, the little lights underneath it will tell us which wheel is getting light and that traction control is actually, you know, applying the brakes to a given wheel. This yellow light tells us that hill descent control has been applied. This one tells us which setting the terrain response is in. So right now we're in the mud and rut setting. Now this one will tell us, you know, what gear we've selected, what range we're in. Also, the two lights here give us the status of our differentials, okay? Particularly for our center and rear differential, telling us if they're locked or unlocked. So right now, our center differential is locked, but the rear differential is unlocked, okay? So that's what we've got going on. Also, what this screen will give us, now, Ash, don't let the vehicle move, but if you would, just turn the wheels to the left for me. It also, again, gives us feedback on which direction the wheels are pointing. Right? And this is really important because as we're going along, right, we may feel that, like, if we look at the ruts here in front of us, we can be a full turn left or right, yet be traveling straight ahead simply because the ruts are trapped.
Right. Yeah.
So this just gives us some feedback on which direction the wheels are pointing. Okay.
Cool.
So that's what we've got that screen for.
Thanks.
All right. When you're ready.
I noticed that the differential came unlocked there for a sec when I was turning the wheel.
It did, because whenever you turn, all right, well, let's just talk about differentials here for a moment as we're driving along. differentials are a very vital piece to any vehicle. Nice and slow. There you go. But steady, Ash. Keep it going. There you go. To your left, just a touch. Keeping everything nice and straight. You notice as the wheels came back to center, everything, there you go. Looking good. Easy. Excellent. Now, what the differential does is it allows torque to flow through it, okay, in the case of an axle differential, left and right, in the case of a center differential, front and rear. So it's vital to us. It's what allows this vehicle to be a permanent four-wheel drive vehicle is that addition of the center differential. The downside of any differential is the fact that they apply torque to the wheel with the least amount of resistance, which is the wheel with the least amount of traction.
Okay.
So you have to have a way to manipulate those differentials, either by locking or unlocking them. Traction control is another way to manipulate those differentials, you know, limited slip, that type of thing. There's many different names for it. But that's what this is. That's what this is for. And as you were steering, okay, because since we were pretty relatively flat, the vehicle was just like, okay, you know what? Well, we don't need to have that center differential locked at the moment, because if we kept it locked and tried to steer, it would actually make it harder for us to steer.
To steer.
All right, because those front and stop here for me, because those front and rear drive shafts would actually want to turn at different speeds whenever you corner, but with that center differential being locked, they wouldn't be allowed to. So by unlocking it, it allows it to corner a bit easier. So, excuse me for just a minute, guys. I'm just gonna
move that out of the way.
Take care of that here for a second.
I mean, we can't go around it.
As soon as those guys show up, they've got the machete. We'll just we'll make it go away.
All right.
So go ahead and apply the parking brake. Transmission goes to neutral.
It's on.
Okay. Put the transmission in neutral. Now gently release the foot brake at this point. Back on the foot brake, and then into park. What this does is it puts the weight of the vehicle on the parking brake and not the parking pin that's in the transmission, right? Because as I was walking back here, whenever you put it in a park, I just heard a clunk as that pin just gets slammed into the transmission,
really?
And we put the weight of the vehicle on the pin, not the brake. So mechanical sympathy is what we refer to with this. So we're just getting the best performance out of the vehicle, and yet it's being easy on the vehicle.
I see.
You're stalking a Land Rover. It's somewhere out here in the hills of North Carolina. Hard to find. It's an elusive animal. Call me and let me know if you see it. Ah, there it is. Gone in the brush.
Gotta love that Asheville clay.
Keep going.
Well done.
See how the back tire is very inside the wheel well, and the front tire quite stretched out. The cross link system is enabling us to play with the different lights. See again here in the van.
There. Good deal. So now we're up. So now we're up here. You can feel it. Now at this point, no throttle. Just gently release the foot brake for me, and let's see if we're going to be able to move. So idle is going to be able to, you know, bring us forward now at this point. So now you're literally going to work this brake and step it down here inch by inch as we come down off this rod. There you go, Ash. Looking good. Front end's looking good. Just a touch to your right. Good. Slow it way down now, because now we got to get this exhaust down here. This is going to be the challenge. Just doing what you're doing, Ash. Great. Slow. Turn a little to your right. Good. Stop there for a second. Hold there. Keep going. Go forward a little bit further now. Slowly. Stop there. Go forward, slowly. Stop.
Really close?
Keep going. Slowly. Slow. Keep going. Stop. Keep going. Slow. Keep going. Stop there a second.
You can hear it.
Go forward. Good deal. Turn a little to your left.
Good job. But that was a lot more work for you than I was going to guess going up on there. Now, was that...
This is Roosevelt Gist with AutoNetwork, and we're here in Asheville, North Carolina at the Land Rover Driving School. And I have the pleasure of being a guest on my show today is Greg Nikolas, the senior driving instructor.
That would be correct. Thank you for being here.
Tell me a little bit, Greg, why did you choose Asheville to have the next Land Rover Driving School? How did that come about?
Well, actually, the Biltmore and Land Rover actually use philosophy, and that was very important with us as far as being able to preserve the land and yet at the same time still use the land.
Now, I'm sure it goes a little further than that. How did you manage to get, how many acres you have now for the school?
Well, here at the school, we have two different trail networks. One here on the east side of the estate, we have roughly about 20 acres available to us, and then on the west side of the estate, we also have about 4,000 acres of terrain that we have access to.
And you probably don't want to admit it, but you were instrumental in getting that done.
There's a rumor to that effect, yes.
And how long have you been with Land Rover as an instructor?
I've been with Land Rover a little over 7 years, actually, now, and here at Biltmore for a little over a year at this point.
Now, we were out in the most recent versions of the Land Rover product. Talk a little bit about each one and the differences.
Well, at this point today, we were out in the 06 Range Rover Sport, and we were also out in the 06 Range Rover and also really an 05 LR3. And each vehicle is positioned for its own segment in the market. They're all permanent four-wheel drive. They all have traction control, four-wheel electronic traction control, hill descent control. And all the vehicles that we have here all have electronically locking center and rear differentials as well.
Now, in this small group of three that you had with us, journalists from around the country, you had no one who really had off-road experience. Is that the typical client or student for your school?
It is, actually. Yeah, we serve a wide range of students and guests through the program, you know, people who have never been on a dirt road before even, to people who may have been driving off-road, you know, for a good portion of their life.
Now, we're out in vehicles ranging as high as, what, $77,000, I think, or...
Yeah, about 82.5, actually.
Whoa, excuse me,
82.5.
So. Now, the typical Land Rover driver is not going to take that 82.5 car off-road. Why have a driving school like this displaying a car like that that costs as much?
Well, actually, it's a way for us to really show what a vehicle can do, really, no matter what the price tag is. You know, I mean, if you're going to spend that type of money for a vehicle, why not use it for everything that it can actually do as well? One of the big misnomers about off-roading is the fact that people feel that you have to destroy a vehicle every time you off-road, and it's just simply not true. We teach an expedition style of driving. It's how to get from point A to point B, still have a vehicle left over when you get there.
Yeah, it's because we actually did, folks, come back in vehicles. So we didn't have to walk.
That's right, and in one piece. Life was good.
Now, I have an opportunity, you know, at times to test drive for a week Land Rovers. And I get inside, and with the regular dash controls are okay, but when you get down to the suspension controls, the air suspension, the things that the car can really do off-road, they're really intimidating, and most people won't use those features. What about those features for off-roading that can be applied to on-roading that the consumer doesn't know about?
Well, there's a lot of crossover really between those functions. You know, hill descent control works in high range as well as it does low range, meaning it has some on-road capabilities and functions as well. Same thing with the transmission, being able to downshift, you know, using command shift, the manual mode, being able to access those lower gears, enabling us to stay away from the foot brakes a bit more in those on-road conditions. Traction control is the same way. You know, it works for us as well in high range as it does low range, providing the driver with the most amount of control in really any given situation.
Now, a school like this, I'm sure there's some costs that are incurred. What are some of the pricing structures?
We offer anything from a one-hour lesson all the way out to a six-hour full day. And the prices range from $195 for an hour all the way out to $795 for the full day. Now, that's pricing is per vehicle, not per person. So we can take three people plus the instructor per vehicle. So, I mean, if you wanted to split the cost amongst your friends, whatever, that type of thing, it's doable.
Now, is there a discount if I bring my own vehicle?
No discount if you bring your own vehicle, but there is a 10% discount if you're a Land Rover owner, though.
Now, I'm sure you've had some, probably some celebrities that come through your school. Anybody, anything you can talk about that happened unique on the trail? Well, not without using names.
No, actually, you know, it's we tend to get not necessarily the celebrities that you would think of as far as Hollywood types. We tend to see more CEOs, business types of celebrities, that things of that nature.
And how has the Biltmore benefited from having a relationship with Land Rover?
Well, it's a partnership, really, between the two entities, and it's worked out well. We've had quite a few people actually come to the school. Within our first year of operation, we've had roughly 1,200 students come through the school, and a good number of those folks have come to Biltmore specifically to attend the Land Rover Experience Driving School.
Now, even though you are a senior driving instructor, someone has to instruct you when there are changes taking place on the vehicle from model year to model year. How does that occur?
That all occurs with Land Rover North America, you know, through corporate. I mean, we work for, you know, with Land Rover, and so that's how that training occurs.
And is there any special testing that you have to go through to be an instructor?
There is, actually. It's a rather long and intense program, and it's ongoing. And no matter how long you've been working with the driving school, the training is ongoing, you know. As vehicles change, techniques change, there's always something to learn.
Now, and since these are your high-end off-road vehicles, any time that the school is not open because of weather?
No, as of now, no. We've never had to close the school due to weather. Now, I mean, common sense dictates, you know, I mean, if there's a hurricane coming through or a tornado, something of that nature, then obviously being in the middle of the woods is not the safest place to be. So at that point, we would rethink what we were doing. But no, as of now, we've never had to close due to weather.
What would you want to say briefly to someone watching this video that has an off-road vehicle like a Land Rover in terms of the experience of going beyond the gravel road?
Well, the biggest thing, you know, is just slow down. You know, as slow as possible, as fast as necessary. You know, words to live by whenever you're off-road. Nine times out of ten, if you approach things, you know, with that thought process, you'll be able to you know, the hills that you come to. If you don't make the mud hole on the first attempt, odds are you'll still be able to back out of it and then try it again a second time, you know, with a better idea of what you're really looking at.
Greg, thanks for taking the time.
Pleasure. Glad you're here.
This is Roosevelt Gist with AutoNetwork, and I do have my Land Rover Driving School certificate, so I'm qualified. And as always, please buckle up, don't drink and drive. See you next time. This is Roosevelt Gist with Auto Network, and we're here on the Biltmore Estates at the Land Rover Driving School. And one of the senior instructors flew down from Montreal, California, just to be with us today and take us out in the wilderness.
Montreal, Kat? Quebec.
Oh, Montreal, Quebec.
Yeah.
Kat Lemieux.
That's correct.
Senior instructor. Thanks for taking the time.
No problem. Nice to be here.
Now, lady driver, off-road, why?
Why? The thrill, the challenge, the finesse that we have and use for off-road driving, that's what really attracted me to the sport.
And you're a thrill seeker because you do alpine skiing.
That's correct, yeah. So reading terrain, motion, going through obstacles, that's what I love to do.
And you get busted up more on the skis, on the slopes, than you do in driving the cars, right?
That's correct.
How many surgeries have you had now?
A couple too many.
So what attracted you to Land Rover and the fact that you wanted to be an instructor?
The Land Rover name, the brand, the heritage, those are all values that I also share, and that's what drove me to become an off-road driving instructor.
Obviously, driving in Montreal, the course is a lot different than what we have here.
Yes.
That we've been on in Asheville. What are some of the differences?
We're based at the Chateau Montebello, which owns a piece of property that is 65,000 acres of land. 2,000 of it is dedicated to Land Rover. And the terrain is you're on the Canadian Shield, so it's very rock base mixed in with mud, endless mud, and lots of trees also.
So your course of instruction would be different than what's given here in terms of how to use the vehicle and the features?
The vehicles, the basic technique is the same. We use, like Greg was saying earlier, expedition style of driving, so the basics are there. Yes, the dynamics will be a little bit different. There might be less sliding, there might be more sliding. It will adapt to the terrain and the conditions that the terrain is in on that day. We also have winter driving. From January till March, we have our snow season. So we have winter driving out there at those times.
Now, if I didn't misunderstand you, most of your crew is female?
We have a crew of four females in total, and then six male instructors. Yeah.
Now, most of your students, what, 50-50 mix, male-female?
I would have to say that, yes, we have quite a good amount of women drivers as well as men.
Who pay more attention and who end up being the better drivers?
You know what? Everybody's a good listener, and you can get, you know, a good experience out of the driving.
Tell me a little bit about the product itself. How important is the product in terms of going off-road? What, you know, its capabilities?
I'm sorry, I don't understand your question.
How, when you're off-road driving, mm-hmm. how important are some of the features that the car can do, like the downhill descent control? Mm-hmm. How important is that to actually traversing the course?
Mm. Well, the main goal when off-road driving is to forward motion. So the goal is not to lose traction. All the different systems that these vehicles have are to enable that. So hill descent control, basically going down a hill, not using the brakes or locking up the brakes where the vehicle could start sliding. Traction control, going up a hill where it is slippery, muddy. Again, that's to help you keep going in forward motion.
Now, really, in your course that's half a day or 2 hours or whatever, do you really learn all of the techniques and the features of the vehicle in that time period, or do you have to come back for further instruction?
An hour lesson will give you the basic, what you can use, braking techniques, throttle control, and so on and so forth. So you'll get a basic overview of what you can also apply on your everyday driving. For sure, if you spend 2, 3, 4 full day, then you'll go more into depth, and then when you're in situations where it's more of a steep uphill and so on and so forth, you'll have more tools to now evaluate the risk and so on and so forth.
So what excites you about driving around 65,000 acres of land off-roading?
You'll never know what's around the corner. I mean, we have wildlife, we have the terrain. I mean, it's a surprise every time.
And you actually had a dead moose?
Apparently, yeah, we did. We did it first at the driving school. So, yeah, you're quite there out there in the wild. Yep.
Great. Thanks, Kat, for taking the time.
No problem. Thank you for coming down.
This is Roosevelt Gifts with Auto Network, and we're here at the Biltmore Estates at the Land Rover Driving School, and as always, please buckle up, don't drink and drive. See you next time.